The situation in the whole of the Middle East, and particularly, of course, in Syria, also Iraq, is an unholy mess and a human catastrophe on an unimaginable scale, the cause of which is neither more nor less than the American-led invasion of Iraq, which effectively has destroyed Iraq as a nation, as a society. They destroyed the entire state. It's true that the regime of Saddam Hussein was a brutal dictatorship. Of course, that was not the reason why it was overthrown. The Americans, for decades, have been friendly with brutal dictatorships, and they still are friends, of course, with the brutal dictatorship of Saudi Arabia. Of course, that's effectively hushed up. No, the removal of Saddam Hussein was nothing to do with that. It was to do with the economic and strategic and military interests of US imperialism, particularly since the fall of the Soviet Union 25 years ago. Now, the fall of the Soviet Union was undoubtedly a major change in the whole of history, and produced a situation which is really rather unique. Because in the past there were always several powers that cancelled each other out: Germany, France, Britain, America, Russia, and so on. But with the collapse of the Soviet Union, for the first time in history, you now have one gigantic superpower, an economic and military colossus which dominated apparently the whole world. But you see, the invasion of Iraq, what it's demonstrated is the limits of this superpower. Now, the other side of the equation is that the collapse of the Soviet Union weakened Russia, which for a period was paralyzed, was not able to intervene as a world power, which it had been, of course, since the Second World War. You saw this in the Balkans, where the Americans intervened. That was a previously a Russian sphere of influence, a Soviet sphere of influence, and subsequently in the Middle East. With this colossal power of American imperialism came colossal arrogance. They really imagined, and this was expressed in the so-called Bush Doctrine, that America really could determine everything, could dictate to any government in the world, and any government that stood against them or didn't carry out their wishes could be just removed. That was the meaning of the war in Iraq, even more than the oil. It was the fact that Saddam Hussein would not do their bidding, would not do as he was told, and therefore had to be eliminated. The excuse being the attack on the Twin Towers. Of course, the fact of the matter is that Iraq was not involved in that. There were no Iraqis involved in those plans. There were many Saudi Arabians, however. That element is left to one side. And prior to that, of course, let's not forget this. Before the invasion of Iraq, there was no Al-Qaeda in Iraq. None whatsoever. That was alleged, but it was a stupid statement. Saddam Hussein took care of that, at least. He wouldn't allow those madmen into his territory. Now, on the other hand, with the destruction of the Iraqi state, there's been all kinds of undesired and unexpected consequences for American imperialism. To be honest with you, they're a little bit thick, the American imperialists. They don't have the same understanding and the same finesse as, for example, the British and the French imperialists had in the past. And they behave, in the Middle East in particular, but also in Afghanistan, the American imperialists are behaving not like a bull in a china shop, but like an elephant in a china shop. And in these brutal interventions, imperialist interventions, they've put the cat among the pigeons. They've upset the apple cart, if you like. In Iraq, they destroyed the Iraqi state. Instead of using part of Saddam Hussein's dictatorship, if you like, to exercise their control indirectly, they went in with both boots. They destroyed the Iraqi state, they destroyed the Iraqi army and so on, thereby creating a power vacuum within Iraq, which of course had to be filled. Now, who do you suppose filled this power vacuum? Well, first of all, Iran. The Americans cynically used the Shiites, who were oppressed by Saddam Hussein's regime, it is true, they cynically used the Kurds and the Shiites for their own cynical purposes. But in the process, of course, they opened the gates to Iran. Now, previously, there'd been a kind of balance of power in the region between Iraq and Iran. In fact, during the long war between, a very brutal war in which millions of people were killed, the long war between Iran and Iraq, the Americans supported Iraq. They supported Saddam Hussein. They supported Saddam Hussein, as a matter of fact, in attacking and gassing and oppressing the Kurds. That's also been effectively hushed up. When they removed Saddam Hussein and removed the Iraqi army, they removed the only power that could balance, if you like, the power of Iran, which now effectively runs Iraq. That's an interesting side effect, which they didn't expect, they didn't anticipate. In fact, the Americans have anticipated nothing. They understood nothing, they anticipated nothing, and of course, they've caused, in the process, they've caused a complete and absolute mess, even from their own point of view as imperialists. The other element which entered the equation, thanks to the American stupidity and the American brutality, is of course Al-Qaeda. Now it's an extreme version of Al-Qaeda. They call themselves ISIS. They change the name every 5 minutes, but we know what we're talking about. These jihadi monsters, they are monsters. These jihadi madmen, they are completely insane. But of course, as Shakespeare said, though this is madness, yet there's method in it. These mad dogs, if you like. Now they're attacking American imperialism, and the Americans don't like it very much. But it was all right, by the way, when they were killing other Arabs. That was fine. But when they come to kill Americans and kidnap Americans, then of course it's not fine. That's how these people operate. This mess has spilled over into Syria. Now in Syria there was originally, you could say, a popular uprising, in part at least. It had some revolutionary content originally against the unpopular regime, the regime of Assad. Yes, but that didn't last very long. Immediately with the intervention of Saudi Arabia, which is the main reactionary power, the main counter-revolutionary force, together with Israel and Turkey, and Qatar also, you can add those dogs into this equation. But the Saudis undoubtedly represent the main force of counter-revolution in that area. You saw that in Bahrain. Again, you see the hypocrisy of the imperialists. They keep very quiet about the suppression of the people of Bahrain in their struggle against the Saudi dictatorship. And now you see this brutal Saudi intervention in the Yemen, which again is hushed up in the West. They prefer not to dwell upon this, where the Saudis are bombing hell out of the civilian population of the Yemen. The Saudis intervened immediately with large amounts of money. They got plenty of loot, of course, because they're sitting on an ocean of oil, with money and arms to support these the most reactionary elements in Syria. The jihadis, now they're called ISIS. There are other groups, of course. The so-called moderate Iraqi opposition, Syrian opposition, I beg your pardon. Yes, but in reality there is no moderate opposition, no moderate Islamic forces in Syria. It's relative. In reality, they're all extreme jihadi monsters, as a matter of fact. They're all involved in cutting throats and crucifixions and kidnappings and rape and all this, and gangsterism and all this business. The Americans, of course, have been trying to support a section of these monsters. They are monsters. They're actually Al-Qaeda. That's a fact. They're supporting Al-Qaeda in an attempt, in a vain attempt, I would say, to overthrow Assad. Now, you see, the other element in the equation, to go back to what I said earlier on, is Russia itself. Ever since the fall of the Soviet Union, and by the way, the Americans pulled a dirty trick on Russia. President Reagan promised Gorbachev that if he wound up the if he wound up the Warsaw Pact, then of course NATO would also, he implied, be wound up. It hasn't been. It was a unilateral act on the part of what used to be the Soviet Union by Russia. NATO has not been disbanded. On the contrary, they've been continually advancing into previous Soviet spheres of influence. Poland joined the first of all the Baltic states joined NATO. Then Poland joined NATO, and so on. They've been chipping away and trying to gain control, grab control and put a ring fence around Russia, which of course the Russians don't particularly like. They intervened in the Ukraine. That was the last straw as far as Putin was concerned. Now the Americans suffered a setback in, first of all in Georgia. They had a warning in Georgia, but they tried that trick. They tried to get Georgia to join NATO, to grab control of that. The Russians intervened militarily and crushed the Georgians, of course, without any effort whatsoever. Then they tried it on in the Ukraine, and frankly, they've got a bloody nose. Now, of course, Putin is in a strong position. I think his support rate within Russia is about 90%. And he now feels free to intervene on a world scale, of course, pursuing his own interest. And we mustn't forget that Putin is not progressive. Putin defends the interest of the Russian oligarchy, of the wealthy gangsters that control the Kremlin and control Russia, unfortunately, at the present time. So we mustn't have any illusions about Putin. But he felt free now to intervene in Syria. It's quite amusing. He turned up at the United Nations and he was supposed to be a pariah. Nobody was supposed to touch him with a barge pole. And here he turns up and he's the center of attraction. The Americans really, the fact of the matter is, the Americans don't know what to do in Syria. They haven't got a clue. And the reason that they don't know what to do, this is quite interesting. It's quite interesting because Trotsky predicted, you know, before the Second World War, he made the following brilliant prediction. He said that the Second World War would end in the victory of American imperialism. And he said American imperialism would become the decisive force on the planet. But he added a very interesting afterthought. He said, yes, they'd become the dominant force on the planet, but they'd have dynamite built into their foundations. Now, you see, that's literally the case, isn't it? Particularly, you saw that with 9/11, with the Twin Towers. Dynamite built into their foundations, you saw that. They tried to stamp this out by throwing their weight around in the Middle East, trying to dominate the Middle East, of course challenging Russia, in effect, in the process, because both Iraq and Syria were Russian spheres, Soviet spheres of influence, rather. The fact is that they failed. They failed miserably. They failed miserably in Syria, and the fact is that they in Iraq rather, and they failed miserably also in Afghanistan, as we've seen with recent events. The Taliban is running amok, and the Americans can't do anything about it. They've got to keep troops now in Afghanistan because they have failed. That's what I meant when I said that you see here the limits of American power. It's astonishing. Because, after all, there is no Afghan army, really. There is no, on the part of the insurgents, that is. It's a ragtag gang of gangsters, actually, mixed up with this religious nonsense. But they're gangsters. In Syria and Iraq, it's the same. There's no army confronting the Americans in Iraq. It's a gang of cutthroats, irregulars, you know, guerrillas, and yet they can't intervene. That's the fact of the matter. They're powerless to intervene. Why? The reason is fundamentally that the American people, the people of the United States, are fed up now after a decade or more than a decade of foreign adventures, of military adventures. which cost billions of dollars and many lives, of course, were lost. American lives, apart from the Arabs that died, many more, of course. But there's a war weariness now in the States, and there's also the beginnings of a radicalization. You can see that with the Bernie Sanders campaign. But as far as the military question is concerned, people are fed up with it. They don't want to know. They couldn't get a vote through Congress a couple of years ago to bomb Syria. And even now it's doubtful if they could get a vote through. Well, they are bombing, of course. That's the point. They are intervening in Syria. That's made easy for them because of the atrocities committed by ISIS against American civilians, beheading innocent American civilians, and filming the consequences. These people are really real monsters. Yes, but so are the American imperialists, even bigger monsters. Are they responsible for these monstrosities in the last analysis? Let's not forget that fact, against all the hypocrisy that they try to tell us in the press and the television. So Obama is intervening. He can just about get away with that, with bombing from a great height, where the risk of losing American lives is not particularly great. You're bombing from a great height. Yes, but the bombing from a great height seems to have been singularly ineffectual, doesn't it? All the hundreds of tons of bombs that they said that they've dropped, they say that they've dropped, on ISIS targets, you'd think that they'd have wiped them off the face of the earth. They haven't. And they can't. Precisely because ISIS is not a fixed military target, but it's a mobile, small groups of irregulars moving around the desert very quickly, and therefore the idea that you could defeat that enemy by bombing from a great height is an illusion. You can't do it. In general, wars can never be won by air power alone. I know they try to say that they can, but they cannot. I mean, Hitler bombed hell out of the people of this island, of Britain, in the Second World War. That didn't win him the war. It just drove the people into the arms of their own government, that's all. Didn't succeed, despite all the bombing that took place. No, in order to win a war, you need troops on the ground. Boots on the ground, I think, is the expression they like to use. Boots on the ground. Well, where are they going to get these boots on the ground? They can't. American people would not allow American ground troops to be sent in, because that would mean casualties, and it would be politically unacceptable, especially for Obama. No, and so they're in a pickle. They've got a problem here. How can they defeat? On the one hand, they very late in the day they woke up to the danger from ISIS, and it is a danger to their interests. But what are they going to do about it? Now, the only possible explanation, well, of course, is the Kurds. And the Kurdish fighters, the Peshmerga and so on, have put up, and the PKK in particular, put up a very heroic fight against these ISIS creatures. Yes, but I think that the Kurds are mainly interested in conquering their own territory and establishing a Kurdish independent state, which they seem to be well on the way to establishing now, both in Iraq and in Syria in particular. They've got control of that part of the country. But I don't think that they're very keen in carrying the fight outside their territory, which would be necessary to defeat ISIS. So there's limitations as far as the Kurds are concerned. Plus now, of course, they're in a conflict with Turkey, which is playing a monstrous role. But I'll deal with that, if I have time, in a moment. Now, the only possible force, therefore, whether you like it or not, that could conduct a military campaign, a successful, an effective military campaign against ISIS, against the jihadi mob, are the Iranians, of course. And Iran, in practice, controls what happens in Baghdad, what happens in Iraq, because it's a Shiite-dominated government. And as you know, Iran is a predominantly Shiite, it's a Shiite state, in effect. Now, the Iranians have been intervening in Iraq, there's no question about that, with Revolutionary Guards, as they're called, and with professional army, Iranian army officers at least, and almost certainly ground troops. I don't think there's any doubt about that. They are conducting the struggle inside Iraq. The Iraqi army itself is a useless a useless bunch. The Americans have tried to build an army which they hoped to control in Iraq. They failed. You saw that a few months ago. They ran like rabbits. In the first serious clash with ISIS, they ran away. And that's happening all the time. No, they need the Iranians. The Americans need the Iranians in Iraq. In Iraq, of course. Syria is a different matter. They need the Iranians in Iraq. And I think that's got a lot to do with this deal which they signed over Iranian nuclear weapons, which was a big victory for Iran, by the way, and a big humiliating climb down for the United States. That's why the Israelis were furious about it. Netanyahu was foaming at the mouth, but it didn't make any difference. The Americans had to reach some kind of a modus vivendi with Tehran because of the situation in Iraq. There's no question about that. Now, Syria is a little bit different, but here the same thing applies. Assad obviously had a hell of a fight on his hand, and he's lost a lot of territory, lost a lot of lives. ISIS is advancing. Yes, they're advancing. Why are they advancing? Well, they're advancing because they're backed by Saudi Arabia and Turkey, fundamentally, and of course the Qataris and the other wealthy gangsters that control the Gulf. That's the reason. They have a huge supply of arms, of weapons, of money and so on, a never-ending supply from these countries, particularly from Saudi Arabia and from Turkey, which is playing a dirty reactionary role in all this. So Assad was losing, in effect, up until recently. The Iranians, of course, are supporting Assad. They're also using Hezbollah, which is quite an effective, tough fighting force from the Lebanon. They understand that if the jihadis overrun Syria, Lebanon will be next. And, of course, they can't accept that. So they've got their own interests in fighting. And undoubtedly, they're very good fighters. But now the Russians intervened. They threw their sword into the affair, and that's made a fundamental difference. Despite the howls of protest from London and Washington, they just stepped in and Putin said, "All right, you want to fight the jihadis? We'll fight the jihadis." Yes, but they're not just going to fight ISIS. Their intention, their aim, which is not the same as the aims of the Americans and the British and the French, their aim is to defend Assad because he's their man. He's a loyal supporter of theirs. And they want to build up a base of support, of course, rebuild the support which they had in Syria and in Iraq. And in my opinion, they will succeed. The Russian military interventions transformed everything. You know, the Russians have blasted anything that gets in their way, starting with the enemies of Assad, the so-called moderate opposition. Of course, there's howls of protest from London and from Paris. Look, you're killing these lovely people, these wonderful Democrats, and so these moderates. The moderates are just 100% just as bad as the other crowd, as the ISIS crowd. As I've said earlier, the same reactionary, fanatical cutthroats. If they were to succeed in overthrowing Assad, by the way, they would throw Syrian society back 1,000 years. It's terrible. Throw it back to the Dark Ages with their Sharia law and their beheadings and their crucifixions and their oppression of women and their stamping out of education and so on. It's monstrous. In that sense, it's not a bad thing that they're getting a bloody nose, and they are getting a bloody nose. The Russians are kicking hell out of them, and they will continue to do so despite the protests from... it's quite amusing, the Americans, "Oh no, you're going to cause an accident, our planes will come. We don't know what you're doing, why don't we reach an agreement? Why don't you tell us the plans, what targets you got to bomb?" They don't tell them the targets, because if they did so, there wouldn't be no targets left, because the Americans would tip off the other side. Now Putin, you can say many things about Vladimir Putin, but stupid he is not. And weak he is not. He's now acting the tough guy for his own purposes. And therefore, the Americans, really speaking, have been completely and absolutely outmaneuvered. The Russians have run circles around them. They run circles around them on many occasions. They ran circles around them over the question of chemical weapons, where they were trying to use that as an excuse. It was just a transparent excuse to bomb the jihadi monsters, but to bomb Assad. That's what they wanted to do. And the Russians reached a deal with Assad that he handed over his chemical weapons. He doesn't need chemical weapons, for heaven's sake, in order to fight those monsters. The Americans were outmaneuvered then, and they've been outmaneuvered since. They've been outmaneuvered now yet again. The Russians, in effect, have presented them with a fait accompli. They said, look, I think they informed in inverted commas, the very day that they moved into Syria. They sent them a message by circuitous routes. Hey, boys, look, very sorry, we're in town. You know, it's like the Western films, you know. Seen these films of John Wayne, you know. This town ain't big enough for both of us, partner. Well, if it ain't big enough, the Yanks will have to go. Because the Russians are not going to go. They're hell-bent, the Russians are determined. And together with the Iranians, who've stepped up their support, there's no question about this. We know the Russians are shipping in, because they denounced this on Western television, large quantities of arms, and they'd be very good arms. The Russians have got very good weapons, very sophisticated modern weapons, which will be more than a match for anything that the Saudis can hand to the jihadis. And therefore, I believe that the tide has turned. Now, what will occur now? That's another matter. Because, as I say, Putin is also maneuvering, and he's maneuvering in his own interests. And he's talking about a political solution and diplomacy and negotiations. At a certain stage, there will be negotiations, I don't doubt it. But it'll be negotiations on Russia's terms. No question about that. And if the Americans don't like it, they'll have to lump it. Assad will not be overthrown. The Russians won't allow him to be removed. For the foreseeable future, I mean, at a certain stage, they probably would be prepared to get rid of him, because they're quite cynical, just as cynical as the Americans if it came to that. But what they will not allow, what the Russians will not allow, is for the American imperialism to take control via their agents, the Saudis and so on and so forth, and the Turks to take control of Syria. I note that the Russian intervention really was stepped up when the jihadi crowd was moving towards, dangerously close to a Russian base, a big Russian base in the west of the country, and the Russians said, thanks, but no thanks. We're not having this. And that's the result of it. So therefore, you can say that the Americans, really speaking, have been defeated. They've been defeated, in effect, in Syria. And the Saudis also, they rant and they rave and they foam at the mouth and so on, and they say they're going to do all kinds of terrible things to Russia. I can't see what Saudi Arabia can do against Russia. And if they did anything stupid, then the Russians would be able to retaliate very seriously. So that's just piss and wind, if you'll excuse the expression. So therefore, the position is really a terrible. I mean, the main victims of all this mess, of course, is the poor people themselves of Syria, who are fleeing en masse, desperate to escape. If you see the plight of these poor refugees, it makes your heart bleed to see this. And of course, the West makes all kinds of hypocritical noises, yes, and then they close the gates. They're responsible for this mess. They alone are responsible for this mess. And of course, they make crocodile tears, they shed crocodile tears about the fate of these refugees, and then they stop them. Now they say they're going to build camps, very nice camps, concentration camps, not much better, on the frontiers, outside, but keep them out, that's the idea. That, incidentally, is probably the reason why they've softened their tone in relation to Russia. Especially Merkel, of course, who's directly affected by this, because they need to reach some kind of solution in Syria, stop the conflict, stop the war, in order to send these refugees back. And they will do, by the way, the very next day. After all, the only reason that they've admitted them is because they're asylum seekers who are fleeing from war. That's the argument, fleeing from the danger of being killed in a war. Unfortunately, there's no way that this war can be stopped anytime soon. It'll only be stopped, of course, it's clear to me, when the jihadis are decisively defeated. That means that Assad will remain where he is, yes, of course. And the Americans, if they don't like it, they're going to have to lump it, I'm afraid. After that, I don't know, the Russians will reach some kind of a diplomatic agreement. And that will be that. But either way, it is a terrible human tragedy, that's perfectly true. It's a human tragedy, yes, but that tragedy is caused entirely by the monstrous, barbaric conduct of imperialism. First of all, American imperialism, and then, of course, all the running dogs, the French, the British, and all the rest of them that lick the ass of the Americans and do everything that they ask. And then they put on this horrible hypocritical mask of so-called humanitarian and democratic concern, which, of course, is nonsense. It is a mask behind which, of course, lurks the unspeakable, ugly, vicious, brutal face of imperialism.